to everybody. My name is Tatiana Gavrilova. I'm a chair of the program committee working with St. Petersburg State University. But here I'm because I'm the head of St. Petersburg Division of Russian Association for Artificial Intelligence and together with Dmitry Muromtsev. It is the third time when we welcome the conference on computer engineering and semantic technologies. I'm very happy to see all the participants and all the guests of the conference. The conference normally is not so big, but because the community of people who are working in this area, they are not so big, but the quantity is not so important, the quality. And I'm very happy, I'm sorry that I have no chance yesterday to open the conference, so we will decide that together. Today they will be reopening, yeah, because of my business trip, I'm sorry. But I'm very happy to introduce our guest speaker and our plenary talk, which will be done by a really great person in artificial intelligence and in knowledge engineering in particular. It is Professor Enrico Motta from United Kingdom and Open University, and the team he is working with is well known in all the community all over the world by their works. So, welcome again, Lisa.
Well, thank you very much, Tatiana. I think it's the first time anybody ever introduced me as a great person, and I will always be, you always have been my gratitude. As you can hear, my voice is not as fantastic as it normally is, so please bear with me if I rely on it to get some water. Okay, so I'll start. I guess I have about 50 minutes, something like that. Yeah?
Yeah.
50 minutes?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Now, as you can see, I've slightly changed at least the title of my talk, but the title reflects a little bit the content as well. Because I really like, when I discussed with Tatiana, my background, my life has always been really knowledge based systems and knowledge engineering. That is the kind of sort of ambitious process of building computer systems which actually reason about the world, which have some model of the world and know what they are doing. So when I saw that, actually, when I realized that the title was really about knowledge engineering and the semantic query, but instead of talking about understanding ontologies, let's really focus on what is like the knowledge engineering the age of the semantic query. So as you can see, I changed slightly my title, and which means that originally I was planning to talk a little bit about human-computer interaction and ontologies. So I'm not going to do that part. So if you are disappointed, please go to the organizer and get your money back. Hopefully the talk will be still nice. And if anybody is only here because he wanted to see the visualization of ontologies, but I'm happy to give a demo during coffee breaks or later this evening. Okay, so let's start with the talk. And what is one of the key premises of this talk? Basically, as I said, we have been doing knowledge engineering for a long time, but we never had something like the semantic web. That is, in the past, I would say, 10 years, there's been the emergence of a semantic web in the sense that really that there is a lot of formalized knowledge out there which is openly accessible. And this is really opens up interesting new possibilities that were not possible before. This is really what my talk is going to be about. And what important thing to emphasize is that when I talk about semantic web in this talk, I really talk about anything that is out there which is represented in a knowledge representation formalism. In fact, one can actually say anything out there that I can actually process. In theory, I don't really care whether it's expressing an IDF or not, as long as I can process. Of course, if it's expressing an IDF or out or some other double pass or whatever, then at the very least I have subject objects predicate or I have ontological structure which allows me to do a little bit more than, for example, if it's just tags or for songs like data or other types of data. So basically, what I'm going to do, or try to do this talk, I might not be able to squeeze everything in 50 minutes an hour, but I'll try. So basically, I want to say, this is really opens up new possibilities, and there are new things that we can do, which we could not do before. And I will talk both about a little bit about kinds of high-level issues, as well as showing you concrete applications in the structures. And also, the other thing that I really want to spend some time on is, again, because for the first time ever, we have the possibility of actually studying essentially knowledge representation in the wild. You know, go out there and find 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 ontologies. So we can really do these kind of large studies, empirical studies, about what, you know, what do ontologies look like in a way which was not really possible before, when you know, there were very few ontologies and people with this data in behind closed doors. So as I say, this talk will oscillate a little bit between kinds of slightly ambitious additional points and much and very concrete, very fine-grained points. Okay, so let's start and say, okay, what are we talking about? I mean, there are videos of the future of what knowledge engineering is about, but basically, knowledge engineering is about building a body of knowledge, basically, you know, acquiring knowledge from somewhere, putting it in a computer form, in a way which allows a system to behave intelligently, and in particular to do problem solving or support for decision making in an intelligent way. Now, this sounds like, you know, really pretty much hacked kind of a very reductionist kind of definition, but actually it's exactly the same as one of the fundamental hypotheses in AI, which is the knowledge representation hypothesis, which was which has been around at least since the 70s, but was comes from the best formulation is the one by Brad Smith in 1982 in the preface to his thesis, and especially for the students in the audience, I recommend that they go and read that. And basically, what Brad Smith said very precisely, well, the assumption behind a lot of stuff that we are doing in artificial intelligence is that really the more knowledge you give to a system, and the system, the more likely, let's say, the system is to behave intelligently. And that's to be really, you know, guess there is a causal relationship, knowledge, intelligent problem solving, intelligent behavior. And this is how it seems obvious, but actually has not been obvious in AI for many years. Indeed, it's only in 82 that somebody actually wrote it down in a formal, in a reasonably precise way. And of course, the moment you accept that this is what knowledge engineering is all about, then automatically the problem becomes, okay, assuming we know, is there a point? Is there a point there? Has anybody got a nicer point there by chance? Yeah. Okay, so I've got a point. A point, yeah. Well, thank you. So basically, okay, assuming that you know we are sort of clever enough that we think, okay, we can really assuming we are clever enough that we can we know how to do this bit, of course. Yeah. As for our assumption, the assumption is that our system is intelligent if there is enough stuff here that drives the whole behavior, which automatically means, okay, how do we get this? So very quickly, this became, of course, one of the key problems in AI and knowledge engineering. And the interesting thing, again, this is actually particularly, I think, useful for the students. Very often, if you read in the literature, when people talk about the knowledge acquisition bottleneck, the emphasis is very often on the epistemological aspects. They say, oh yeah, because representation is so difficult and the world is so complex and our company is not good enough, you know, some people spend a lot of time on all sorts of AI problems from the setting, no monotonic reasoning, meta-level reasoning, etc. So of course, these are really good problems. But in reality, actually, that's hardly the issue in knowledge engineering. The issue in knowledge engineering has always been an economic one. The process of building an intelligent system is a very expensive one. And even if you succeed and you build a knowledge base which is able to drive your system, typically then you have to maintain it. Hardly any system can just, especially a knowledge-based system, can remain fixed over time. And the bottom line is that there are not that many applications where the cost-benefit trade-off is positive. So typically the main problem is really an economic one, it's not an epistemological one. So how have people tried to address this problem?
Well, of course, Doug Leonard got a huge amount of money back in the 80s to build Psyche. And the idea was, okay, let's just build once and for all this such a huge body of knowledge, which then would, you know, can drive not one system, but thousands and thousands of systems. Of course, this really didn't work. And again, there are basically both fundamental and pragmatic issues there. The fundamental issue is essentially that there is really a dead knowledge base that will solve the problem in the universe. And indeed, if you look around nowadays, the way the field has evolved, there are all sorts, for example, even if you just focus on top-level ontologies, there are four or five different alternatives which subscribe to different viewpoints. It's not so easy to say which one is better. But even more, for example, the latest research is not really more so much on monolithic ontologies, but it's more on patterns, much more fine-grained components that solve specific modeling issues. So, in a sense, the big problem with Psyche from an approach point of view was really this assumption that you could just solve the KV bottleneck by building a large knowledge base. Of course, in addition to that, they made all sorts of practical mistakes, like they didn't give it to anybody, which of course, if the idea was to allow experimentation and the thing to succeed. And eventually, by the time they released a decent version of Psyche, it was far too late. There were better alternative out there. An alternative approach, which is actually the one of which I was mostly involved, so I got neutral in this perspective, as you can imagine, was the one that said, okay, you know, let's make knowledge engineering a real engineering discipline, like, you know, a robust engineering discipline in which, like in other types of engineering, you have certain types of problems, and for these problems you have robust ways to address them. So what we did essentially, we looked at classifying all the types of AI problems that were out there, from design, classification, scheduling, planning, monitoring, etc. And then a number of groups, both in North America and Europe, went about building solutions for these different types of tasks. For example, my own work focused on, we did a lot of work on design, we did a lot of work on classification, and also scheduling. And of course, you don't just want to build a piecemeal solution. So there is the overall framework to distinguish between definitions of tasks, definitional methods, and having ways, for example, to plug in domain components into generic shells. Now, this would require a different talk, but this worked reasonably well. At least, we started building systems which were more robust from the engineering point of view than the classic rule-based systems. But of course, it wasn't really addressing the core problem of AI, or at least one of the core problems of AI, or at least one of the ambitions of AI. This is where, can we build systems which are not brittle? Can we build something that actually, doesn't just do this tiny bit of clever problem solving because it's specialized on this tiny bit of clever problem solving? In a sense, although we could say that work actually advanced the state of the art dramatically, still it was really more kind of going around the key problem of building large knowledge bases which were not brittle as opposed as tackling it head on. Okay, so now we come to the semantic web, and we can say, okay, what has changed with the semantic web? Well, in a sense, not a lot has changed. I mean, if you look around the systems that are built nowadays, they don't look a lot different from the ones that we were building 20 years ago, and some other people were building 30 years ago. The fact that a knowledge base is kind of on the web, or the fact that we use a web knowledge application, doesn't actually fundamentally make any difference. In fact, that some people, for example, I had some interesting discussion with Alan Rector in Manchester, and both of us are, way he's older than me, but both of us are old enough to say, well, actually, the tools we had at the end of the 80s were kind of better than the ones that we have at the moment, which is kind of a little bit depressing. But nevertheless, let's forget about, specific limitations at the moment of, kind of systems that are being built. But if you look, if you go up to the kind of visual level, you can say, well, actually, the semantic web is not just about, having some markups so that once I change it, you can aggregate my review with another review somewhere else because they know they're both reviews and they have some structure. What you can say is that, well, actually, it's really a kind of historical moment in which, for the first time ever, we have an infrastructure that allows this large-scale distributed process of publishing data and knowledge on the web in a way which is not interoperable automatically, because typically these subscribe to different conceptualization of different ontologies. Actually, it's a start. And again, for those of you who know a little bit about the history of AI, there is really a very, very good paper by Max Steffi in 1986 called the Next Knowledge Medium, where it really says, okay, well, if we really want to do something about this knowledge-based system and go beyond this brittleness and this kind of piecemeal and this kind of ad hoc solutions, what we really need, as you say, an information network with semi-automated services for the generation, distribution, and consumption of knowledge. And of course, the semantic web is not really that, but it's actually not a million miles away. So basically, an interesting hypothesis is that, well, okay, so what knowledge engineering in the age of semantic web could look like is basically, you know, this is the same diagram as before, but now the knowledge is not a knowledge base that we have built, or is not side, but the knowledge is something that can be acquired online by looking at what is available online. And of course, that is the Link Data Cloud. They just put it there with a nice picture, but actually, I'm not necessarily limiting myself to the Link Data Cloud. The Link Data Cloud is a subset of all the stuff that is out there. So this is kind of slightly crazy hypothesis and this kind of crazy beginning. But luckily, I had the funding to go and explore this idea. I first got the funding, then I started publishing these crazy papers. So basically, what we did about somewhere around 2006-2007, we launched a research program, which we called the Next Generation Semantic Web Applications, which is always a good title, because even today, it's called Next Generation Semantic Web Application, therefore you will always be ahead of the curve. And this is, you know, again, for those of you who are interested, we published a kind of vision-like paper in IEEE Intelligent Systems back in 2008, where we say, okay, you know, can we really build a new class of systems here, and how are we going to do it? And the nice thing about this paper is that it's not only as a vision, but it starts actually giving some examples of the kind of systems we can try and build. So what are the research questions? Well, the research questions is basically, okay, can we do, you know, can we do something a bit more interesting, so you know, getting some data about the toilets and some data about the bus stops, and then putting them together to see whether, you know, from where is the nearest toilet to the nearest bus stop in all the data. But can we really do something that has to do with brittleness and, you know, open knowledge and things like that? If you want to do it, how do we do? I mean, we certainly need a technical infrastructure to do that. But the other thing, and again, these, when we started, let's say, about 2006, 2007, everybody I was talking to was telling me, well, actually, you must be kidding. I mean, the semantic web is all rubbish. Just, you know, all the quality of the knowledge, the quality of the data published are really rubbish. The ontologies are rubbish. The, you know, most of them are built by people who don't really know about ontology engineering, or they're just translated from something which is not ontology, ontology in the first place. So there was a really big, big quality question mark, and everybody predicted, well, you're not going to get anywhere simply because the quality is so bad. Of course, the quality is just one of the dimensions that really distinguish trying to do this kind of stuff from building those nicely engineered, high quality systems that we were building in the 90s and 80s. I don't want to spend too much time on this, but obviously, you know, in a classic knowledge-based system, you, as a knowledge engineer, you have complete control over the data, which typically means if you know, it means that if you know what you are doing, the data are high quality. Of course, there is no issue of provenance. Typically, you are not stupid enough that you use different ontologies, but you make sure that your conceptualization is integrated. And also, of course, the size is typically not that big, simply because it's so expensive to build very large knowledge systems. Of course, you know, you start talk about a system which uses semantic web information dynamically to do problem solving, well, then you get all these problems. I mean, distributed provenance, you don't know how, you don't know much about the quality, you don't know whether you can trust those data, and everything is very dynamic. So an interesting thing, implication is also that, you know, again, as I showed it in my slide earlier, when talking about the different types of knowledge-based systems, you know, you talk about planning, you talk about diagnosis, and you talk about scheduling. So basically, the marginal bit there, the intelligence, was the ability to do complex reasoning. Now, of course, the moment you talk about these semantic web systems, you know, where you actually dynamically acquire knowledge as you need, well, you can't really do that complex reasoning because simply the point, you cannot trust the quality of the knowledge, plus there are also computational reasons. So basically, you also get this shift that we actually see in a lot of applications which use both web information and semantic markup, that is no longer just about inferencing and deduction, but it's about typically combining, for example, statistics with semantics. So essentially the point is that intelligence is a side effect of simply having lots of stuff there to work with. Okay, so we say, okay, let's try and do this. And of course, if you want to build an application which use, you know, which is able to access knowledge on the smart web and then use it to do something interesting, well, typically you need something in between. You can just go and every time you have a query, look, you know, across 150,000 different resources scattered around the web. So the first thing you need is what we call a gateway. And of course, again, in the past, I would say, 7-8 years, different research groups built different gateways. I don't have the time to do an overview, but basically what happened was basically we decided we had to build our own simply because all the others were primarily for human beings, were essentially search engines that allowed people to find ontologies, to find data on the web, but they were not gateway in the sense of supporting programming. They didn't provide an API, they had typically the kind of document-centric, you know, Google-like view of the web as opposed as a knowledge-based view of the web, where again, you know, if I'm looking for semantic information, I'm looking for distances, I'm looking for classes, I'm looking for relations, that's what I'm not interested in documents. Document is not exactly what I'm after. So we built these things called Watson, which is still up and running, and you can use it. There's a public API that you can play with, it exists. And the key thing for this research program is really that is the third bullet point there, that is a development platform. As an API, it allows people to find information on the web which may be relevant to their need. Again, this definition, one won't spend much time on it. The key thing essentially is that there are a couple of servers out there. There is a crawler. All the ontologies are indexed, and all the data indexed are put in a nice repository that are made very efficiently accessible to through an API to systems. Now, one important thing to emphasize here that again, because we are interested in knowledge as opposed to documents, one thing that Watson does, it does a lot of analysis. Again, this is really primarily another talk, but for example, one thing that we've been working on is finding relation, automatic relation between ontologies. So for example, very often ontologies are just cut and paste to other ontologies, or they are evolution other ontologies. Where Watson has a lot of, we have a kind of ontology of ontologies called DOR, which lists the number of relations that can occur between ontologies. And Watson automatically is able to capture many of them and organize the ontologies in the network. And you know, if people are interested in that, I can give you pointers later. Okay, so we having built Watson, we said, okay, well, let's now try and build some applications. In fact, we built quite a few. I will just focus on those two. One called a global one called Skeleton, because basically they support. I will focus on Evolva Skeleton because it's kind of linked to the knowledge engineering. Evolva supports ontology evolution and Skeleton supports ontology matching. So they're kind of sort of nice ways of using the technology to support the process of knowledge engineering itself. The other, this one, Power Aqua, is a question answering system that that allows people to ask questions in another language and find an answer if this answer is can be found anywhere in semantic web, even aggregating information from different sources. And to my knowledge, it's the only system today that is able to do that, dynamically matching ontologies which may be heterogeneous to provide an answer to a complex question in another language. Another one is one flaw is about using semantic web information to help navigating structures like in Flickr, you know, taxonomies, let's say tag systems, which typically are not very good for navigation simply because there is no relation between the tags and there is no meaning to the tags. So flaw automatically imposes a kind of semantics on these tags and supports navigation. But as I said, I will focus on these two primarily because I like the fact that they support ontology gene tasks. So I'll start with Scarlett. Does any of you know about Scarlett by any chance? No, good. Because yeah, this is kind of the very first system we built and it's quite old, so I'm always worried about the people that already have seen it. So what Scarlett does is it uses this paradigm, basically scouting the semantic web for knowledge to support the particular ontology matching. And ontology matching actually is incredibly, is a rather boring problem actually. Plus is an unsolvable problem because actually the old notion of matching ontologies is actually completely incorrect. I mean, typical ontologies are built with different viewpoints, so you can't really match them. But nevertheless, it's an important problem for the community. And typically, the way it is done is by using label similarity, of course. If you have a professor in one ontology and a professor in another ontology, there is a good chance they may be talking about the same concept. But also, for example, you know, the more clever mechanism they use also structure. So, for example, if you have you have a faculty member which is a subclass of person here. Okay, let's start again. If you have a faculty member which is a subclass of person in ontology, assistant professor which is a subclass of faculty member here, you can say, well, probably, you know, these may be the same thing, and therefore these may have a certain degree of similarity with that thing. And of course, in addition to that, some systems use background knowledge, in particular WordNet use a lot. So, let's say, around 2007, the best performing systems were systems which typically use a combination of these three methods, structural similarity, string matching, and typically they use a little bit of background knowledge like WordNet. So we say that, okay, well, why, what's the point of spending a huge amount of time trying to find whether a professor is a faculty member, when maybe there are other 20 other ontologies out there on the web which have already accepted this fact. So we thought, okay, well, let's try to use the background, the web as background knowledge, including the semantic web. And we just came up with, initially with a completely obvious strategy, which is very trivial. It is basically, if you want to map A to B, you just ask Watson, hey, is there an ontology which where there's something that looks like A and something that looks like B, which are mapped. And of course, the nice thing about this approach, in contrast with the previous ones, this basically gives you a number, and they can only give you kind of same as, or what, well, if you're lucky, they can give you a subclass one. Yep. But it's not really that semantic. Now, the nice thing about this approach is that because actually we're using semantic structures as background, then actually we can use fun enough semantics to get more information out of these in our final ontology matching results. And we can even reason, so for example, if you know that A prime is a subclass of C and C is disjoint with B prime, then we can conclude, for example, that A prime is disjoint with B prime, which means we can bring it back to our initial query and say, well, actually, A and B, they are related only in the sense they have to be disjoint. In fact, one of the problems we had, we built our first special scala, and then we entered the ontology alignment benchmarking competition, and we created a lot of problems to the organizers because we were the only ones who were able to find also this kind of mappings. Everybody else, the mapping was just a number. For us, the mapping was subclass of, same as, or disjoint with, and they didn't know how to score our mapping. So the nice thing was that the next year they changed their mapping score, and the mapping score became much more semantic, which was kind of, I mean, even if our approach was crap, at least we kind of improved the benchmarking exercise. So just to give you some complete trivial examples, for example, you know, imagine you want to match the ISWC ontology with the SWRC ontology, and you say, well, what's the relationship with the research academic staff? Well, you ask Waltz, and Waltz tells you, well, there's a KA2 ontology, which is actually was the first attempt at trying to do these things about plastic characterizing semantic information about academia back at the end of the 90s. And I said, well, there is actually one ontology which says this is subclass of that. So, okay, this may be. And of course, the other thing can be much, you know, it can be more clever. You can actually go up the subclass of hierarchy, although it's not particularly clever. And of course, this sounds a little bit crazy because, well, but, I mean, how do you know that this researcher is the same as this researcher? How do you know that this is the same as this? And how do you know that these viewpoints then are compatible? Actually, we don't. But actually, this is no different from any other ontology matching approach. This is actually one of the problems with ontology matching. But then, of course, we can do something a tiny bit more clever. That is, well, because we have 8,000 ontologies out there, which we collected as our background knowledge, we don't need to have the answer only in one ontology, but we can actually search across ontologies and find these chains of reasoning, and then bring them back here. So, for example, if you want to know whether cholesterol is an organic chemical, well, you find one ontology which tells us that it's a steroid, and then we find other ontologies which has this other chain here, and then we bring it back. And this sounds pretty crazy, and everybody predicted that our results would be completely terrible. So, in fact, this is an example of this strategy too. So, for example, like we want to find the relation between ham and seafood, and there is one ontology which tells us that ham is a subclass of meat, another one says that meat and seafood are disjoint, and then we can conclude that ham and seafood are disjoint. So we at the time we were working a lot with FAO, the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations, and of course they have some really very, very large ontologies. So they're not really ontologies, they're more like a thesauri. And in particular, one problem they have in their community is that there are two main standards, one is the UN one, another one is the US one, AgroVoc and NALT. Very often documents are marked up in one or the other standard, but typically not in both. So the problem of aligning these two ontologies is an important one for them even today. So we applied Scarlett to this problem, which then also became a benchmark problem for the community. And lo and behold, we achieved a 70% precision, which at the time, again, I'm talking about 2006, 2007, was pretty much the same as the best ontology matching system that was available at the time. But the really interesting thing was that the 70% precision was didn't really change by using S1 or S2 alone, S1 alone or including S2. Our prediction was that the more you crawl around the semantic web, the more mistakes you introduce, and that didn't seem to be true. Which was quite strange, actually, but true. But the other thing that was really interesting was, as I said, we achieved a 70% precision, which means, of course, we had a 30% error rate. Now, the interesting thing about this 30% error rate is that half of those errors were errors with our algorithm to do with ambiguity. The other half were errors to do primarily with the fact that the ontologies were a bit rubbish, or the viewpoints were so completely distinct that it could not be measured. So that was a very interesting result, because basically it meant where 85% of the information we found that was relevant to solve this problem was actually good quality, or let's say the quality was good enough to allow us to achieve correct results. Now 85% is a lot. I mean, I can certainly live with 15% of rubbish in the semantic web. And this was quite surprising at the time, because most people thought that the ratio would have been the other way around. 50% good quality, 85% bad quality. So the thing is, well, it depends what you do, of course, with your knowledge. So good quality, bad quality is actually a relative assessment. Depends on the problem you're trying to solve. Anyways, as I say, we found that actually we could theoretically push our percentage from 70% to 85% simply by solving these ambiguity problems. For example, a classic example is this one. You try to, in null, they have the notion of sports, and in aggregate they have the notion of game. Now, of course, game in aggregate means game in the zoological sense. But most ontologies talk about game as a sport, so Skynet was fooled by that. So we actually worked with a guy at the University of Saragossa, Jorge Garcia, whose PhD was on disambiguation. He spent 6 months in our lab, and basically he came up with interesting solutions to solve these ambiguity problems. And basically the way he approached it was basically, if I look at the, because these are two ontologies, and because these are ontologies as well, these terms don't come in isolation. They actually are part of an ontological context. So that means that I can actually explore the neighborhood around this term, and explore the neighborhood around this term, and come up with some notion of similarity. And I can do the same for these. And then, of course, I can have a threshold and say, well, if the labels are not similar enough, I'm not going to bring those mappings through. In addition to that, of course, you can also use WordNet and say, okay, if I'm trying to map A to B, I can look whether in WordNet there is any intersection in the synthesis between these two terms. So this basically means you can come up with a number of strategies, one based only on WordNet, one based only on ontology mapping, and then you can merge them in different ways. In an optimistic way, you take the most optimistic or the pessimistic way. This is exactly what we did. We came up with a strict filtering or a permissive one by combining the two things. And this is, for example, one example in which we actually don't go ahead with this, we matching sports and game, because simply those particular meanings are not matching WordNet, and the ontological context is not sufficiently similar. Another example is this one with, again, cattle and mammal. This is, the seed set intersecting WordNet, and moreover, also, the ontological context gives me a better score, and therefore I can go ahead. Basically, if you look at the precision improvement, there are the different schemes, but basically you can see that it is consistent with our prediction. You can go up over 80% with, of course, the permission, the more permissive you are, the more precision you get. But of course, that is at the expense of recall, of course. Recall is better to be very restrictive. So basically, if we use the restrictive scheme, around here with a threshold around 0.27, we get the recall which is still pretty close to 90%, and we get also precision which is about 85%. So that was a very first result, and that gave us a lot of confidence that actually we could really do something with this background knowledge. So what we did then was, well, among other things, we tried to use this approach to ontology evolution, which is actually quite an important problem because simply because it takes so long to build and maintain ontologies. And I guess everybody knows, you know, intuitively what an ontology evolution is. You have an ontology, you're using for something, for example, to mark up a certain archive of documents, or to support semantic digging, to support semantic search. And of course, the archive grows all the time, new terms are introduced, and you need to change the ontology. And that's really a very expensive process. So we build these systems called Evolver. And basically what Evolver does, he has a kind of text analyzer, extracts terms, and then you, from the new documents that are produced, and then you use various forms of background knowledge, including Watson, you know, Semantic Web, and WordNet, to evolve the ontology. And actually, let's skip this one, as is already said. So let's give you the example. So again, because we always like to test our ideas on our own organization, many years ago, even you know, as that must be now 14, 15 years ago, we decided we needed, you know, we have our own internal newsletter in our laboratory, which is called Planet News. And basically every day, or at least every week, you know, new stories are published about what happens in our lab. And so sometime around 96, 97, we decided, well, we needed to have semantic search. So we did what the knowledge engineers do. We built a nice ontology, which described the lab. And then we had mechanisms by which automatically automatically there was a little bit of markup of these stories to support a better form of search. And that was it. And then the PhD student who worked on this left, and this ontology was never updated. So the markup was never essentially, never improved over time. So we said, okay, let's try Evolver and see whether we can evolve the ontology automatically. So just to give an example, for example, let's suppose we have an ontology which I can't see the colors from here. Okay, so if our ontology has the actually let's take this one, which is nicer. If our ontology has the concept event, and our text analyzer finds this term in a document which is not covered by ontology, we can say, well, how do we bring, do we want, first of all, we have to say, we want to bring this term to the ontology. And then how we bring it, well, because we have Scala, we can say, well, let's see whether Scala finds us a way to bring it. And for example, Scala can say, well, actually, I have a place that tells me the place is subclass of region, actually the region is subclass of place, and there's also this relation, the event occurs in place, which is actually probably in our ontology already, so I can bring that up. It may not make much sense actually, but let's do it anyway. So we tried the concept of initial solution, and basically we found that the precision was acceptable, was again around 75-79%. The problem is that he was suggesting all sorts of new additions to the ontology, which didn't make any sense. I mean, which were kind of technically correct, but logically very idiotic. So for example, let's say, you know, if I enter in a completely different domain, you know, if I have an ontology about electronics, and suddenly, you know, the pizza concept appears in a document, well, it doesn't necessarily mean that I want to have pizza as an extension to my ontology. I mean, when we build ontologies, we have some idea of what is relevant and what is not relevant. And that's again something that is not logically correct or incorrect, because if I put pizza under the right superclass there, which actually I can't read, but I imagine makes sense, is logically correct, but is also rationally idiotic. So we thought, can we address this problem? Can we only get the ball to bring things to my ontology which are relevant, which makes sense? Actually, I think I cut too many slides. So the first approach was, again, let's look at this ontological context. Let's do this like with Scarlett and Leon showed. Let's match ontological context and see whether there is intersection. And that is turned out to be less good than the pattern-based approach. That is, one of our PhD students did an analysis of when things seem to be relevant and when things seem to be irrelevant. And basically found that there were certain patterns that seems to be actually quite useful. So basically this is a new concept that we want to bring in. So red is the red are concepts which are not in my ontology, blue are concepts which are in my ontology, and stars are concepts which are intersected, which intersect both the new stuff and the existing stuff. And basically what it turns out is that, you know, if there is a certain degree of intersection and according to these patterns, then there is a very good chance that this information is relevant. Don't ask me, we don't have a theory about the patterns. This is just empirical, but they seem to work very well. It would be interesting to really understand why, I mean, what is this to do with relevance that seems to correlate at least with these patterns, but we don't know. So, a concrete example is, for example, if I want to, I have a notion of event, of course, in my ontology, and let's suppose we forgot to put tutorial as a type of event in our ontology, which may be possible because we primarily do research, so somebody might have forgotten about tutorials. So we find suddenly we have a document which talks about tutorials, and we say, well, so tutorial is this one, is the new concept, and is a subclass of event. Event is actually something which is in common both in our ontologies and in the one that came from Scarlett. And also, there is also another subclass here, which is, let's say, a sibling of the new concept, which is in common, which is conference, plus there is something else that exists here, but let's only worry about these three here. So this triangle here give us confidence that this not only is correct, but also is likely to be relevant. And if this is the case, this is actually a relevant concept. I will skip this other example and just give you the so we did the experiments with three different domains. They were different enough to make it reasonably interesting. And basically what we found was that the patterns-based approach was a lot better than the approach based on the overlap of the context, which is the one we were using for the disambiguation in ontology matching. In particular, as you can see here, it was on the academic domain one, or actually academic was 51 and 2, was 54 for relevance versus 7, and also for irrelevance, because basically some statements are relevant, some statements are irrelevant. Some statements, basically, the experts cannot decide whether, you know, there's not enough consensus or relevance or irrelevance. So this is why there are two different measures. And again, basically, you can see that the pattern approach outperformed the overlap approach in every single domain, in some cases by, you know, quite dramatically. In fact, it's actually much nicer to look at it graphically. You can see essentially this is the random approach, just a random generator of relevant and irrelevant. You can see by using the context matching approach, you get a little bit more of these reds going towards the top, which is where you want. And with the pattern based ranking, basically, you get a much, much nicer distribution of reds towards the top and whites towards the bottom. The whites are relevant and the reds are the relevant ones. Okay, so these were two of the several experiments we performed, which basically showed that there are a lot of concrete applications also to do with ontology engineering itself, where this approach seems either to at least match the state of the art, or actually, as in this case, outperform dramatically the state of the art. Okay, so according to my clock, I still have 10 minutes, is that correct? Okay. So the final 10 minutes, I wanted to talk about something that actually I find even more exciting. That is actually two, as I said at the beginning, actually, let me just get, you know what? In addition to the kind of sort of using the semantic web as a source of background knowledge to develop new interesting methods to do various things, for the first time in history, we now have access to a huge quantity of formalized knowledge, and this has never been the case before in the history of AI, in fact, in the history of mankind, for that matter. Of course, formalized, you know, if you're happy to read many books, we have access to non-formalized knowledge, but formalized knowledge in a way which is actually processable, that is available online, this is the first time. So it's kind of interesting to say, okay, what does it tell us about knowledge representation and in general, knowledge engineering? So we did an initial study, which was pretty boring, just to see which were the domains which were covered, which were the type of the complexity of the underlying description logic, etc. So we found some interesting obvious stuff. For example, in 2007, most information was obviously put by computer scientists, as it typically the case. So this is not so interesting, and this is something already mentioned. So I go straight to something which I think is much more interesting. That is okay. The moment. It's quite difficult to say how many ontologies we have on Watson, because it's very difficult to decide what is an ontology. If you crawl the semantic web, Watson has around 300,000 semantic resources in his repository. They tell me about 9,000 of them, we can say these are 9,000 different ontologies. So one interesting thing is to say, okay, can we measure to what extent these ontologies agree and disagree? And again, this is not the same as logical consistency or logical inconsistency. For example, if I have an ontology which talks about pizzas, and Tatiana has an ontology which talks about Bellinis or Chicken Kiev, the two ontologies may agree or disagree, but I'm not sure. I mean, they may simply be talking about different things. But certainly, they may not be inconsistent. We may be able to put, in fact, even more, if I have an ontology about cars and there's an ontology about apples, we may be able to put them together, there's no inconsistency, but that doesn't mean that they agree or disagree on anything. So we came up with certain ideas. So ontologies can agree, and at the same time they can disagree. That means there are certain parts that agree, certain parts that disagree. So there has to be a measure of agreement and a measure of disagreement. And these to some extent are independent, but also, there must be a correlation. So what we did was, we basically produced these tables to decide exactly given two statements which have the same subject and object, but they have a different predicate in terms of, for example, our primitives. How do we classify them? So basically, we have a very simple 0, A1, A2, 1 agreement score, and 0, D1, D2, 1 disagreement score. So for example, If obviously subclass agrees completely with subclass, and agrees to quite a lot of extent with equivalence, yeah. But for example, disjoint in subclass means that there is zero agreement, yeah. So if somebody, if an ontology says meat, let's say seafood is a subclass of meat, and another ontology says seafood is disjoint with meat, then there is a zero agreement. These two statements are completely contradictory. So that was the level of statements. Then, of course, we can generalize to ontologies, and we can say, okay, basically, the agreement with the ontology is essentially the average of the agreement for all the relevant statements, and the disagreement is the same thing. And then basically we can also talk about consensus and controversy. To what extent there is consensus about a statement. So Tatiana says Enrico is a great person. So that means, is there a consensus in my repository about Enrico being a great person? And that's the difference between agreement and disagreement. Or is a controversial statement, which is probably far more likely, where basically it's y minus the module of the agreement.
Okay, so let's do some experiments. I will just take one reasonably trivial domain, which is to do with seafood. So, what we can do with this system is that we tell Watson, is there agreement about the way seafood is represented in all the ontologies that we know about? And of course, there are various statements in which seafood is mentioned. And particularly, the most interesting one is the one here at the bottom. In fact, the two here at the bottom. This one says, seafood is a subclass of meat. And there are basically four ontologies which say these things. And then there are 16 ontologies in which there are statements which relate seafood to meat. So, in four out of these 16 ontologies, the relation between seafood and meat is characterized as subclass of. So in 12 ontologies, the relation between seafood and meat is not characterized as subclass of. For example, there are 8 ontologies in which the relation is characterized as disjoint. Now, as I showed earlier, these two things, and of course, as anybody who knows how, these two things are inconsistent. Yeah. So basically, these 8 ontologies here are inconsistent with these 4 ontologies here. And this is quite interesting to say, well, there are some people in the universe that think that they have this particular view of seafood, and there are some people in the universe, and there are more, that have this other view of seafood. Has anybody any view about which one is correct and which one is incorrect? Does anybody know anything about meat and seafood in this audience? Come on, don't be shy, I'm not going to give mouth. Dimitri? Which one do you... Just say which one you prefer, disjoint or subclass of?
Probably it's subclass of, because if we consider the meat as a muscle, then fish also have the muscle, and all this seafood stuff.
Okay, this is good. Yeah, actually, this is an interesting perspective. This is a good one. Is anybody in favor of the other one, this joint? Why?
That's my understanding of the short meat.
But you see, even that, and of course, this is a trivial example that, you know, you can find much more interesting examples. But the bottom line is essentially that thanks to this approach, we can actually find different viewpoints on the semantic web, and basically, essentially there's this cluster of yellow ontologies that seems to have a certain view of seafood, and there is I don't know what color is now here, this bluish black ontology, which seems to have a slightly different view. So if you try extract the viewpoints, basically what we concluded was essentially this is the kind of, sort of technical, I mean, formally this is the correct, formally in the English language seafood and meat are disjoint, because basically you have meat, fish and seafood. Meat is associated with not fish meat, but it's associated with mammals. But actually, if you, for example, are a vegetarian, for you, or for example, if you're a vegetarian restaurant, you're characterizing the menu of the restaurant. In fact, even in restaurants which are not vegetarian, very often seafood, basically all the vegetarian stuff is put somewhere here, and then all the non-vegetarian stuff, including seafood, is put somewhere else. So, what is the point? The point is that if you take, ontology engineering is typically done top-down by people who have very formal principles on how to do it, and there are theories, etc. But the interesting thing about this bottom-up approach is that it highlights viewpoints which are not necessarily the ones that people think about when they speak from the first principles. So, for example, what we think is very, very interesting is that, we can maybe generalize this approach and then really analyze the semantic web on a large scale to see what different viewpoints on matters or substances appear. For example, different notions of time or different notions of processes, etc. But even more practically, for example, we build a little tool that allow when you build your own ontology, for example, using the Neon tool, this tool tells you to what extent to the ontology you are building. You know, it gives you a visualization of the matching between what you are doing with respect to the consensus you find in the semantic web. So of course, my student took one of my ontologies as an example. Unfortunately, some of the distinction here have gone because the colors, right. So that's a little bit okay. So but basically, you know, about 2003, I built an ontology that was needed by a project. And then I put a statement which was duration is a physical quantity, which is probably not really completely correct. And basically this tool automatically highlights, unfortunately we can see here because the color has disappeared, this is supposed to be red. And basically it tells me, well, there, you know, Enrico, you might want to know that there are quite a few ontologies out there, including Psych and Sumo, which talk about duration, talk about physical quantity, and either they do not say that duration is a class of physical quantity, or even say that it's two classes are disjoint. Okay. So that's such a quite nice little plugin that gives you kind of instant feedback as you build an ontology to see to what extent what you're doing reflect the consensus. And this is another, you know, example of the same thing, which again, so, you know, using the same ontology, highlights for you the things where there is more consensus, and in particular, like in this case, the aspects of the ontology which are more controversial. Okay, so this is it for today. So just to conclude, then I just re-emphasize the key points that is, you know, first, we have this resource we never had before, and basically, you know, we can use it, I think we can use it in a much more clever way than it's being used at the moment. At the moment, most users of this information not dissimilar in nature from the way we were building knowledge bases before, you know, taking certain components, putting them together and then doing something. I think there is some interesting, certainly on the research side, there is some interesting research that can be done, which could not be done before. And then the other aspect is really, you know, knowledge representation has always been, to my knowledge, a top-down endeavor. And I think now, for the first time in history, we have enough data about representation that we can start doing some, you know, bottom-up experiments. And I think this is very, very interesting, especially because it can open up new ways of looking at ontologies and representation compared to the way we have always looked at these things. It's typically either from a philosophical point of view or from a computational point of view. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.
Things about practical applications. May I start the discussion and questions? Everybody is welcome for questions. My first question is very simple. It's just about your beliefs. Do we really believe? I understand that automatically we can match, align, evolve ontologies. But what do you think about the generation of upper level ontologies? Do you believe that they can be generated automatically, or you are on expert side of this gap?
No, I don't think they can be. I think to generate them automatically. It is interesting again because there is now so much knowledge out there. For example, you know, if you look at Evolva basically generates automatically ontology. I mean, it evolves automatically ontology. And the process, there is no human intervention anywhere. However, it doesn't do it really so much by generating new relations, but basically by looking at what people have done in the past. And by
So in a sense, I think what can be done is to have something more powerful than Evolve, in which, for example, like, you know, you may see the ontology, even a top level ontology with certain key categories that you are interested in. And then, for example, you know, a combination of Evolve and then this work on agreement and disagreement can try to evolve the ontology in a direction which is, you know, not only logically consistent, but also that seems to subscribe to a certain consensus view in the community that I think can be done. And of course, here, my examples here, they didn't use any text extraction technique. But of course, now information extraction is good enough that actually you can also take some information also from structures that are not ontologic. So I don't know whether you can generate new top-level ontologies, but I think you can certainly go into that direction.
I can agree, because here Dmitry Muromtsev and his team several years are working on the ontology of very good domain, explicit, which is optics. But even on that level of optics and physics, which is, you know, not fuzzy domain but very hard domain, we have a problem on the first level, on the upper level, because there is a lot of different views. So that's why I really don't believe on the generation of ontology of the beginning, on the beginning. Then other things can be done when we have that, for example, two or three big things, and we can do with them. But when we are doing first, coming in the domain, for example, in the new domain, I really don't believe. But maybe I'm not sure. Okay, welcome. Questions, please.
No, I mean, I completely agree. In fact, in general, I don't like to tell people what I'm going to do next, because I maybe always like first to do things and then to talk. But one thing that we are planning to do next year is to do an empirical study of top level ontologies using these instruments plus some other techniques, with the idea of trying to get a better understanding of which top level ontologies work better and which one, in practice. Not because they subscribe to Platonic philosophy or some other philosophy. So hopefully that kind of work may also provide you help and input for attacking this problem.
Thank you. Please. Dmitry Kudryavtsev.
I have provided a generic question too, and you show the slide with library of reusable components, where you show method ontology, task ontology, domain ontology, and they were integrated in order to create any application. It was, as I understood, it was something like history and traditional viewpoints of something like 10 years ago, maybe I understand. And currently, I see that there are a great deal of methods and approaches which deal with domain model and domain ontologies and the major part of instruments. But what about the procedural knowledge of problem-solving methods, task ontologies? What's the situation with these types of reusable elements? Is it appear that they are more application specific and it's not very helpful and useful to deal with them and so on?
This is a very painful question. I mean, it's because there's been for about 20 years, let's say from 1980 to 2000 more or less, there's been a lot of great work on these reusable components for AI. And then after 2000, basically everybody seems to move on the semantic web. So in a sense, there is not much research in that area. I think what happened was that there's been a shift between kind of performance systems which do diagnosis, systems which do planning, monitoring, to kind of knowledge management systems which simply whose job is to help you manage your corporate data, corporate repositories. As there's been, you know, this shift, then of course problem solving methods become less important.
Having said that, I think about two or three years ago, Frank Van Ammen's group, they did an interesting study in which they analyzed the applications which were built on the semantic web, in particular the applications which were entered for the semantic web challenge using this approach, you know, in terms of these kinds of as modern component. And they found basically that there were only like four or five different types of applications which could be characterized in terms of these knowledge modeling frameworks. So the bottom line is that I think this framework is still used as an analytical framework because it gives you a way to understand applications, not simply from a computational point of view, but in terms of what kind of knowledge they use. But at the moment, I'm really there's really not much happening, simply because there's not much, to my knowledge, there's not much happening on the performance system side. As I was mentioning earlier to Tatiana, I'm the editor-in-chief of the International Journal of Human Computer Studies, and we are just about to publish a special issue on 25 years of knowledge acquisition, in which we have asked 10-11 people who have been in the, you know, at the forefront of knowledge acquisition, knowledge engineering research since the early 80s to tell us, you know, where is the community going, what's happening. And if you read that, especially if you look at a special issue when it comes out in a couple of months, a lot of the debate is, you know, how come this was great research, how come it's not being used now in the new scenario, so the semantic web. And there are some ideas about what can happen in the future.
Thank you very much.